Hey there, it's nice to see you. We are going to be working through a tutorial that's provided for the Clap Crate, a state-of-the-art command line argument parser for Rust. My aim for this tutorial is to really kind of boost you up in case you see this thing and you're like, oh my goodness, it's huge. I don't know what I'm doing. Goodness gracious. I want you to know that creating a command line utility is definitely something that you are capable of, and I want to really help guide you through that process. I'm just going to give myself a little bit more space by deleting the sidebar from the tutorial, and now we can start. We actually need to start even before the quick start, so we need a project. Cargo new, let's create a project name. We'll call it Tutor, and I will move into Tutor, and then I want to execute cargo add clap, which will add a new dependency, and then I also specify a feature flag that I want to include, which is derive. Derive is a relatively new addition to clap, and that brings a really nice API where we define a structure. And this procedural macro parser does all the work for us. Cargo add has added a dependency inside our cargo.toml file. Cargo.toml is the metadata for the project. And now our task is to kind of get going. Obviously, the quick start guide is not intended for people who are just starting out. So I'll try to skim through it as fast as I can. And then actually, I might just, we'll do it piece by piece, but I don't want you to get bogged down. Don't feel as though you need to learn all of this right now, because this is essentially showing you all of the functionality available to you in one go for people that really like a fast option. Let's talk about the structure that we're building. We have an optional name, and we are creating some name argument. We've got a config file, which is actually converted into something that can open. A path buff is kind of like the equivalent of a string, but for things on the file system. I've got a debug flag, or actually a number, so I count. So we can sort of dial up debugging information if we would like, as well as a subcommand, which is command, which is an option of commands, which is defined here over on the left. And the subcommand we can do is test things. And then we have a Boolean flag here, list. So you might wonder, like, well, what on earth do all of these things here do? One way to experiment or explore is the debug macro. Let's see if this gets what we want. It might. If it might not, we'll see. It works with execute cargo run. It does a bunch of work to kind of go and get the code, does all of the compilation. It's very, very interesting. Waiting for the compiler. Oh, CLI cannot be formatted with the, so this thing here, derived parser, cannot be formatted with the debug trait. So we need to actually ask for another derive, and which is debug, because we want to kind of inspect or interrogate the output. We'll need to do it in both traits, in both types. And hopefully this will get us a little bit closer to where we want. Aha, so we've got a CLI that has taken an argument. We've got none, 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 zero, zero, come on, none. If I add dash dash name, Tim, try pass name as a value, use dash dash name. That's what I did. Unexpected argument Tim found. That's a curious state of affairs. I wonder why that happened. Let's look back at what we actually specified. So the name argument is, it says here optional, but it doesn't have this arg attribute. That's interesting. So if I just try to provide dishes. Aha, name is now defined. So this is how we just specify a propositional argument. We don't add, let's find out what if we can change this. So I added dash dash. So this is kind of a long thing. And that provide that's the same argument. Well, sorry, that's the same behavior. And so you can see here that this arg syntaxical attribute kind of provides some guidance as to how the parser should behave. And now I've got dash dash short, I should have a dash n available to me. Compiling again, and now the name is working. I have still got long available, but I can choose whichever I prefer. Okay, let's just have a poke around and find out what happens with the action or arg action count. So you can see here they've got short, long, and action. So if I add, let's add D for debug and then D twice or D three times, we get debug 3. I wonder if it will be smart enough to see that I've applied it 3 times. Yeah, and actually, Clap is really, really good. What are some other cool things you can already do? We've got help, all of the kind of help that you would expect on the command line is available to you. Now, one thing that we haven't really interrogated yet, author, version, about. So what's going on here? Well, and if I provide some documentation string, an interesting command line utility, we'll see that we get some different information out of out. We'll get some different information out of help. We get an interesting command line utility. And check this out. If I go back into my cargo.toml file and I add author, probably going to embarrass myself here by getting something wrong. Say it's Tim Clicks. I think this is how to do it. I can't see Tim Clicks popping up. So this one's actually a bit of a sneaky one, I think, because I've gone and looked at the documentation and it turns out that there is a crate feature help. So the standard template doesn't actually provide the help. At least that's not what it seems to be. Okay. Anyway, I will push on. So we've seen our quick start. It's only 9 minutes in. So apologies if you are wanting a really, really quick start. Let's carry on to experiment with creating our super quick our parser. There we go. There's author. So we can actually, but let's start again. We'll remove all of this and redefine our CLI as being a struct that has two fields, 2 and 1. They're both strings. So we are telling Rust that we expect that they'll be required to be passed in as long arguments. We no longer need commands anymore. And the help is different. We see that we need to specify 2 and 1, and 2, 2, 1 is 1. And we can now get output from our debug macro saying that the CLI2 field is assigned to the string 2, and same with 1. One of the other things that we start out with is the tutorial starts out by describing is that you can also expand these command flags, or I guess the command, they're called procedural macros, or this command proc macro, depending on how you want to say it, and into multiple lines. So if this is clearer for you, that's another option available. And we still haven't specified an about that is different from the doc string, but we can say this is version 0.01, let's say. This will actually succeed. I want to actually fix up a couple of these warnings just so that it's slightly less muddy when we try and get through here. I will remove subcommand, and we no longer require a path buffer. 1, 2, and just see --help. We can see now that, yeah, the author doesn't actually get included in the output, but we do have a version flag, which we can see tutor is 0.01. Interesting. Let's go on to the next section of the code, or at least of the tutorial, and just describing that you can actually use cargo.toml to populate some of the information. And we've already looked at that ourselves. We can use attributes to be, we can actually use these attributes to change the application level. Any command builder can be used as an attribute. So what on earth does that mean? Well, so this implies that you already know about what is this, the so-called builder pattern. Do you remember right at the start we described that Clap has this derive feature which we're including? Well, the command that we're building up has another way of creating it, which used to be the default. This was called the builder. And what we're saying here is that these command attributes can take on any of the function or these method names themselves. If I execute, don't need the version anymore. If I ask for help, I get the output of what would have been a call to a method, but it's actually being provided as a macro. So that's what's meant by the builder function. Any of these functions or methods, and there are many, any of these methods are available to you. And have fun playing with them, actually, because you can actually get a very, very rich amount of information for your users. Okay, let's add a couple of extra arguments, and we are going to start by talking about propositionals. Well, not start. The next thing that we're going to do is add propositional arguments, and so that is where the name things, the name argument that appeared, that kind of confused us right at the start. It didn't have an arg attribute attached to it, and it was a little bit unclear for people like myself who were expecting to pass in --name, we get this kind of bizarre error message that we didn't expect a name. Instead, what's being asked is for a propositional argument. And to do so, we can provide arguments as essentially without a long or a short. I wonder if we can just add arg with no extra information. This is an attribute. We need to provide some attribute information. So this works. We can sort of make it very obvious that we didn't intend to provide long or short, but we did intend for name to be an argument. And so if you would like to do that, that's an option available to you. Now, the other thing to think about is like, well, why is option in there? What would happen if I just asked for name? It's probably quite, hopefully self-explanatory, that Rust will complain that name wasn't provided if we exclude the option type wrapping the argument. Whereas if we say that name is optional, then we don't need to call help again. We're still doing great. Thanks. We get a none in there instead. Cool. Okay. Where do we get to from here? Well, the tutorial is now going to say that they talk about what the behavior is when someone specifies an argument. It's saying that the default thing to do is to set a value. But if we instead would like to accept multiple values, so let's say we had names in here, we might accept it into a vector of string, then we will use the append action. And where does this come from? Well, it turns out that vector actually does the override on your behalf. And that, so that's kind of handy that we have some, sort of by definition, I suppose, for the, so we, let's specify some names, Tim and Tom, and they get collected into names. So the default thing to do is to accept a, or just set a value. But when you specify a vector, you'll automatically collect things up. Now, this does cause a problem if you wanted multiple propositional arguments. It's slightly ambiguous what you actually intend. So be a little bit mindful of doing so. But in the general case, it might pay to note that some types have the ability to have their actions adjusted. It might be useful to just have a very quick segue into checking like what are the kinds of things that you can do with an argument. And here we can append, count, provide help, set a value, set something to true, or set something to false, which essentially provides a flag. And this is the intent that that clap will infer based on what you are specifying. And that is available via the argtypes, well, header inside the underscore derive module. So I just pulled it out from here, I think. Oops. Nope. Default arg action set. Here we go. Fantastic. Let's move forward. Otherwise, I'm just going to get super stuck and probably people are going to get very, very irritated with me. We're now talking about different options that we can provide. So short and long, which we've discussed in multiple places. And the intent here is to enable an argument to be provided in any order, and it will be, order doesn't matter, they can be optional, and it makes it very, very obvious in, say, a script what you intended. So if I was to call my helpful utility or my interesting command line utility in a script, and I add dash dash name, it's very obvious that my intent was to provide a name. These attributes are settable. So we might want to say that name is, for whatever reason, dash dash in, and say Tom just for a difference. And the command line parser will actually bind to a different flag rather than the default, which is just the field name. Flags are things which can be turned off, on and off, and this is the case with booleans. So let's say, or cooleans as the case may be, and let's say that we want to add color, and we just say that color is it just doesn't really take an argument, like this is now name. It's not parameterized, just the presence of it sets it to true. Otherwise, we get false. And that behavior can be inverted with the arg action that we saw before. You could use the flag could actually mean set it to false. I don't like doing that with like no color, for example. I find that having no in an argument is just a recipe for double negatives, and I hate it. So, and there we go. There's set true to accept multiple flags, override action to count, and then we get our verbose counts, which is often the case when we want to like really provide lots of output. A subcommand is quite a useful way to provide more specificity available, or sort of extra functionality and it has a almost exactly the same syntax with as the original parser, except for the fact that it needs to kind of hook in slightly differently via a different derived macro, because they kind of, because clap needs to kind of do some work to link these two types together. And in our case, we are doing the linking with our subcommand. And we'll leave color in there, but say that we'll move name to our add command. And so now we're in a position to, we need to say cargo run, and then our command name is add, and then we want to have a name to, I think that's right. Oh, I need debug as well, otherwise I can't print it out. Tip, pass name. Oh, this is the same problem I had earlier. Ah, yeah, I haven't actually provided, this isn't a named argument, it's propositional. So there we go, useful, or at least I just keep running into the same problems. So I'm just very used to using non-propositional arguments. And we're just talking about different ways to be able to specify commands. Instead of using an enum, you can use your own custom struct, which I think I'll skip. And one thing that I won't skip is specifying how to provide defaults. There are actually two ways to specify defaults. I'm probably going to get ahead of myself. I'm sure that the tutorial explains this, but let's just go with providing a little bit of extra info. So I've got my arg here. And as we know, this is going to say that this is an argument that accepts some value, and it is not possible to skip it. It's not wrapped in option. So if I were to use or follow the pattern that has been provided by the tutorial with this underscore t thing, I need to provide an actual value that is the same thing as the argument. And let's say I'll just use port 8080 for fun. I no longer need commands. I'm going to receive a compiler error warning about an unused import, but hopefully you'll forgive me. And the system is very confused because we provided the default. The system was confused because I tried to specify a name, which I no longer needed. But let's ignore that for now. What I think is important to say is that there are sort of two ways to specify defaults. The default value without the T is as if you were specifying the argument on the command line, and they always come in as strings, and this will then be parsed into the type at runtime, whereas underscore T has done the parsing sort of on your behalf. So the effect is kind of similar, but different in the sense that default value expects a string, whereas default value underscore t expects the actual type. The next part of the tutorial talks about validating our arguments. Now, we have on the left here modes, and we can go either fast or slow, and we essentially want to say that people can only provide a fast or slow as strings. But how do we actually inform clap of this? Well, one of the ways to do this is with value enum. And value enum will go and inspect the enum itself and actually create possible values from what we've specified in our type. I think mode here is a strange thing. I always have this tendency whenever I use someone else's code to kind of want to tinker. And I should really avoid doing so. However, I can't help myself. I feel like mode is the wrong argument name. but I can make sure that I've included it as an argument. Now, the type of argument, so speed is a speed, and we don't use short or long anymore. We want value enum. This will essentially dispatch to all of the validation, and speed cannot be formatted. Oh, I need to debug thing again. Gosh, I'm got every other thing derived. It's going to break on me because panicked have found. Oh, that's an interesting error. Actually, that's a really fascinating error. Panicked found non-required propositional argument with lower index than required. Port was sum is one. I bet that's because I've provided a propositional argument sort of in the wrong place. They should really be right at the end. I'm going to just hopefully bypass the problem by making it required to specify it via a long or as a named argument. And that does actually get past the panic dash help. And we can possible values fast and slow. So that's kind of neat that we've actually been able to kind of push through the problem and also get validation. So let's try and say that we want a speed that is medium. It's like, whoa, invalid argument, medium, possible values fast, slow. So I really like that Clap is kind of going on, you know, to the extra steps of doing all the validation and providing a really helpful error message as well. You can see here, that's actually what has happened when we try to, when the code demonstrating the, sorry, when the example demonstrating the code also does medium, we get this kind of, we get this error as well. Ah, here's a really neat feature, but it's kind of obtuse what's actually happening because we need to invoke another macro in the space of an attribute, which is itself kind of a macro, and it's all a bit convoluted. Now, value parser is a hook into a method. And if we remember back sort of several minutes ago, we talked about how these arg attributes can be essentially used in place of methods. Well, that's what's sort of happening here. The value parser asks or requires a parser, which is something that can take a value and verify that it is true. Sorry, that it matches the expectations. So in our case, we want to say that our value is port that is of a non-zero value. Value parser is U16, a range, and it must be at least one. Zero is not a valid number. We'll just put in, we got a bunch of syntax errors. And see if I can fix some of that. Okay, we get the medium problem again. I'll just call dash help. And you can see here we've got the default. If I try to specify port zero, and I'll just say that I'm going fast. And saying, hello, it's invalid. It must be between 1 and 65,535. Now, I wonder if I can now get rid of this problem. I wonder if this will still panic. No, it does definitely still panic. This kind of highlights that putting propositional arguments in the wrong place of your program can really kind of muck things up. At least that's my take. And I'll be interested to see whether or not you have a similar experience. Okay, now we want to go even further. Oh, it's saying that one of the things that you can do is actually define your own parser. So I'll just show you what I mean. We went port zero and we wanted to go fast. And I am not sure about the syntax because it implies that someone knows what Rust syntax is. You know, zero is not in 1, 2, 6, 5. I think that a nicer way to say this would be is not within 1 and 65,000 inclusive. So sometimes it can be worthwhile to just check that your error messages are actually providing sufficient information to your users, because the defaults are slightly technical. If you had a, I don't know, not, it's unlikely you have a non-technical audience because this is a command line utility, but there is an avail, there is some, there's a hook that enables you to provide your own parser with its own error message by defining what happens during a parser, like during a an error. So you kind of need to return a result, and then you have an error type. In our case, it's a string. I'm going to skip that one, because if you don't know about results yet, and then you are probably going to get a bit lost. And the other thing is that this is a relatively advanced feature that is unlikely that you'll need to hook into straight away. And if you're building your first command line utility, I want you to know that this is a possible, this is something that is possible when you learn more Rust, but it's not required to start. Now let's go argument relations. So this is a, one of the, I think one of the best things about Rust, about Clap, that you can actually say that one argument is related to another, or that it actually conflicts with some other. So we've got a file that relates to that. Let's actually just pull this across. So in this case, what we're saying is that we have an input file that is related to some other input file spec in, and we also have config as well. And to specify config, it requires input, and there's interrelationships as well, which I'm not going to worry about version so much to start with, but let's just kind of take a look and see what happens with the with all of these config things. I only need to bring across these three. Some regular input. I'm always cautious whenever I see a tutorial that explains, say something is kind of simple. Yeah, it's kind of a sneaky word for like pre-assuming a lot of knowledge that readers have. Okay, so I've got three arguments here: input file, spec in, and config. And let's see what our help message says. I don't think I've saved. I need to save main.rs, otherwise Cargo doesn't know to recompile it. And this is interesting. I've got some regular input is the help message. And, but the, okay, so input file, let's just say is hello.cfg, let's say. And that's fine. We can work there. Now spec in, let's try and says that it's part of the group. I think we'll find out what that means soon. Let's just try to specify config without hello. Aha. Oh, no, that's different again. We get the problem. This is a bit of a conflict in the different types, the different places where the errors are popping up. This tip is actually provided by Cargo, but the error is with the file that I'm executing. And the problem occurs because config is only a short argument. So I'll provide conf.config. And then we get this other explanation that the following arguments were not provided. And that is, it requires something from input, from the input group. And so either spec in or input file. So we can start to see that there are some relatively complex relationships that we can build up. To start to understand what's possible, I recommend taking a look at this arg group documentation. So arg group specifies sort of a family of related arguments, and we can go and take a look at what is actually happening. So in this case, in our case, we want to provide a semantic version number that could be specified with major, minor, and patch, or with a single value string. Does that make sense? So we could either provide set-ver version 123 or just any of the flags, major, minor, or patch. And that is what you can do with an arg group. When you create an arg group with a struct, the arg group's name is the arg group's ID is the struct's name. And I don't think that I need to go and go through all of that. This one here is a little bit complicated. Check for the usage of dash C. So if as deref is a way to kind of poke, like it's complicated, is a way to kind of look into an option and pull out the argument if it's there as a reference. It's slightly confusing because there's also an as ref method, and this unwrap or else thing will enable you to perform some function provided here as a closure or an anonymous argument in the case that the config in case input file was not specified. So in this case, what we're doing is that if you have provided a config, then we expect that you, then we know that either input file or specin was specified as an argument. But what we don't know is which one is provided. And this is just a pattern to go and to pluck out one or the other. Now, the unwrap here is because one, either input file or specin must be true. And if it's not input file, then it must be specin. And therefore, the unwrap is safe. And so the examples are getting a little bit more interesting, or I'd say complex. And you can see here that we have a bunch of different options for specifying, or sort of using these arguments. And now, lastly, it's talking about, like, if everything else fails, you can fall back to specifying your own kind of parser. But again, I think that we're now getting to really complex matters, and I'm sure that anyone this far through has probably already, or anyone needing these types of features, knows enough about Rust to get through it themselves. The one thing, though, that is really important is to be able to test what it is that we are trying to enable. And so I'm not going to skip this small section on testing. And I just want to go back to the example here, port, because it's a relatively simple one in the sense of we kind of intuitively understand that this is it's a number, and we hopefully have probably used in a CLI that's asked for a port number before. So the interesting thing about clap is that it's saying something very, there's a hint here that says you shouldn't actually go and manually check every argument every time. Instead, you should pull out the command method, which is what is being generated with these attributes, and then call debug assert. This will break if your CLI is invalid, like if it doesn't satisfy if it doesn't make any sense. In our case, I need to save again. Forgetting. Cargo run. We need a port. 12,321. And what if I do cargo test? Okay, test result is okay. That's useful. Now, that doesn't mean that you're not entitled to also say that you're... Maybe there are some special values that you think are probably not going to be super useful. If we wanted to go and check those, then let's say we wanted to avoid the case where someone specifies port 80, the reserve port 80 and 443. So we don't want someone to set up an HTTP server. And so they're invalid. Now we need to be able to parse our CLI with some invalid data. So how do we do that? And we can't just call parse because that's going to take input from the operating system. So instead, what we need to find is, I think it parse from, which will parse from some iterator, and we can specify a vector of strings. And so in that case, it will be arg0 is the name of the command that we're providing. And let's say we have port 80. And what we want this to do is fail. It won't fail yet. So this is actually, and what we want to say is if port, actually we can say if port equals 80, or this is kind of a poor way to do it, but it will get us through, then we panic. To indicate a failing test in Rust, you panic. That's all you need to do. And now our test has failed. So actually, so this means that our parser has accepted the things that we want to avoid. Now, we need to implement some behavior to go and do that. We want to be able to implement a parser that has a range, which we saw before. And so it'd be something a little that looks a little bit like this, where we have a range, but the numbers inside of it will not allow us to, we won't allow any caller to provide 80 or 443. So we've got a port number, we've got a U size, which is almost actually the wrong type we want. Why not have that as the reason why we are bringing out a wider type than U16 is probably because we don't want the thing to crash early. So if port equals 80, or if port equals 443, then we return an error which says port may not be HTTP. We return an, I'm never sure exactly. So what does the test do now? Oh, well, it fails because we have a syntax error. We're also not actually using this function yet. So I need to go into my CLI thing, my CLI struct, and actually say that I need to go and, oh, goodness me. This has got to be a string, which is something that is kind of annoying when you're relatively new to Rust. Oh, and I also need to provide it an import, get it over here, and bring that in. Got my range inclusive. Aha! And now my test has still failed, but the test has changed, so I get the right behavior. So now what? I'm in sort of an impossible situation where this parse from is actually crashing. It's panicking itself. Well, we now need to ask Rust to use the try from. So you can see we got try parse from there. And we actually want CLI to be, and so if CLI is okay, then something has gone wrong, and now we want to panic. I say want to panic. It's never particularly helpful. It's a scary thing. Oh, we need to invoke the macro. It's not a... And now our tests pass. We've also checked that we can't use 80, and we may as well check 443 as well. Otherwise, we are not actually fulfilling our obligations as people who have documented what we are doing in our test. So that is an overview of the CLAP derived tutorial. I really hope that it has been useful for you. The next thing to ask is, what should we do next? And here are some really interesting resources. They're right down the bottom in next steps. We've got cookbook, but some of the things to really explore are the derive reference, and in particular, talking about some of the things that you can do with possible values and so forth, and arg attributes, like describing that you can skip something or that you can take something from environment variables as well. Lastly, I wanted to have a bit of a shout out to the CLI doc itself, and I'll just bring it up. This is probably one of the reasons why I shouldn't have hidden the side. I shouldn't have hidden the sidebar. The working group CLI is part of Rust, and they provide a really neat book that's provided at rust-lang.org. And we go into learn and then command line, building tools. And I think this is quite neat that the Rust community has taken the time to really provide lots of very thorough information for people that are building with Rust. Let me know if you have any future questions or comments. The comment section is totally there for you. Hopefully you can fill it up and I will get back to you later soon. Bye-bye.